I'd like to introduce our next speaker, Jordy Smith. Jordy is a machine learning engineer. He works here in Amsterdam. He likes to work at the intersection between software engineering and data science. And today he has a nice talk for us about apparently how ChatGPT got access to his to-do list. I mean, he gave it to ChatGPT. And so a round of applause, please, for Jordy.
Thank you. This talk is indeed about how I gave ChatGPT access to my to-do list. But before I go into that, first a bit about me. I'm a machine learning engineer at Xavier Data. Here I help companies build machine learning solutions and other data solutions, ranging from data products or data platforms or whatever people and companies want to do with their data. And in my free time, indeed, I love to work at AI and machine learning related side projects. So this year has been especially cool with the release of ChatGPT and all the other API stuff that has been released. But this is also a bit of my own downfall because I love to add a lot of things to my to-do list. I don't know if other people do this as well, but I tend to add everything I read online to an inbox and it keeps on growing, growing and growing. And it becomes way too large and usually I need to look at it at least once a week to clean it up, and lots of times I don't know which groups belong to what or what to put where. So this becomes long and becomes quite tedious to do. But now with tools like ChatGPT, I was wondering, maybe it can help me. So let's see. So my goal was maybe it can help me find these logical groupings. Like we see here, they're like two example groupings, and move these tasks automatically to these different projects, maybe even create them, move the tasks over there, and make the cleaning part at least a bit faster and less tedious for myself to do. But that was the goal I set out to do. Of course, I asked ChatGPT to do it, but it doesn't know my to-do list, so you get these default answers from I don't have access to that personal information, like all the other safety stuff OpenAI typically gives you. Now, of course, I can copy-paste it into there, but we're software engineers. We don't like to do this. I want to be a bit more lazy than that. So luckily, there are all these kind of APIs. Todoist, the tool I use for my to-do list, has a really nice API that can give you all your projects, tasks that are there, and easily gives you them. Even has a nice Python SDK to use there. OpenAI has a nice API. So we can, just with these few lines, we can already do the same thing I just showed you for manual copy-pasting can now already be automated. So it saves already quite a bit of time. But we're not there yet. These are some example responses you can get. And as you can see, they're all quite differently formatted. And that's the pain with working with natural language, is that there's so many different ways to write the same thing. And that parsing that is really painful in Python. Other things that we still need to do is how can we, this is just an example for getting everything, finding groupings, but I maybe also want to let it move my tasks, create new projects, or let an LLM make a plan to accomplish a bit more abstract task I have for it. But before we dive into that, we need to know a bit of background of how these LLMs work. Like, ChatGPT-3 is just a very fancy autocomplete tool. It has been trained to predict the next word, and the word after that, based on what's already there. So it's just like your phone and the autocomplete that's on there, but a bit more fancy. Okay, a lot more fancy. After that, they did one additional step, is that they fine-tuned it to respond in a conversational style. So you get these like user says something, AI says something, and it's just all still natural text under the hood. We see this typical front-end UI, but under the hood it's still text in this specific format that's a bit easier to parse already. Another thing they did is that it also has been, that they added this prompt instruction, system prompt part, where they tell it how to act in this conversation. So, for example, and we can it has been fine-tuned to follow these instructions. So we can already, if we can change these instructions a bit. So here's an example. If we tell it to follow the response in more of a JSON-like format, it will try to follow these instructions as long as it's kind of understands what you're saying there. And then you can see this kind of JSON-like response, which is already quite a bit nicer if we want to parse that with something like Python. Okay, so all what we do here so far with an API is a bit of clever prompting and injecting additional information. But how do we actually get to an autonomous agent? Well, this is just giving me an answer of how to easily see groupings and which belongs where. But I want to have it do more, like create a new project, move a task from my inbox to that project, and other clever stuff that makes my life a bit easier. So for example, I want maybe something like this. So please, if I ask it, please move all my tasks in my inbox into projects, create a new project if it doesn't exist yet, it should say something like, of course, I'm on it. And in the background, it should ask for all the tasks that are in my inbox, get a nice list over there. Based on that response from the API, it should make a request of all the existing projects. Okay, so nothing is in there. Should make a should decide from, okay, well, maybe I need to create a new project. And then the API says, okay, successful. And then move all the tasks to that specific project over there. And then it's done and says a small summary of what it actually did. It's the ideal way we wanted to act. But how do we go from that chat format to this format? Now, to do that, there are some clever people that came up with this React framework. This is a way, basically a very smart system prompt, that tells it how to respond. So what it here does is first it has to respond with a thought that it can do a bit of reasoning and write what it's thinking, what should be done, make some kind of plan over there. So for example, I don't know the tasks yet, so I need to get all the tasks from the inbox. Then it should write the action it wants to do based on its current plan. So for example, get all the tasks from the inbox, or move task X to project I, stuff like that. And then it should ask for an observation. An observation in this case is just a response from the API. This part is not generated by the LLM. This part is something you ask from the Todoist API. You write it out in a JSON format text, or whatever format you decide on. You get the observation there. ChatGPT can read that part. And you keep on looping there until it completes its tasks. Then in the end, it says something like, I know the final answer. And it just gives the final answer, the response I as a human see again. So how does this look? So here, for the previous example, we would get something like this. Please move all my tasks in my inbox into a project, create a project if needed. Now the AI thinks, okay, first I need to know which tasks are in my inbox. So it says, perform these specific tasks. Here the generation part of the LLM stops. Then it moves to Todoist. I get a list back. This is some Python code, depending on the format, how I give it there. I give the observation back. And then it can reason again about the previous observation and what it has done so far. It reasons about that and then decides from, okay, I need to create a project. And based on that, it keeps on going for quite a while until it knows the final answer. Cool, this is the general background. Let's see how that works in a demo. So here we have a streamlit version of the application. On the left side, we see the example inbox. There are no projects yet. And here in the box in the middle, you see the instruction I'm about to give it. So the instruction get all the tasks in the inbox, try to identify related tasks, think of a suitable project name for these groups. If not such a project exists, create a project, then move all the tasks to their project and ensure the inbox is empty afterwards. So let's see. It Here we see it decided to get all the tasks, all the inbox tasks. It gets a big JSON list. Based on that, it has identified the birthday celebration project should be created. It has been added via the REST API. It now notices specific tasks that needs to be moved there, like this one above, has been moved over there. And it keeps now iterating on that part. And that's the loop we were just talking about, and slowly moving everything over there. And then it gives me the final answer that it has moved everything. The thing I also really like is that it really took the instruction, verify that the inbox is empty. So the last observation you see over there is also an empty list. That's the task in the inbox. So it has double checked it worked, followed the instructions very carefully, but made the plan on how to do it entirely by itself. Pretty cool. Okay, so this is how the final results work. But actually to get there is quite a bit tricky. We discussed the general framework there, but there's some specific implementation details that make it a bit more tricky. So for example, the initial system prompt I had to design to do that is a bit more lengthy, as you can see. First, I need to tell it about the general context, that it's a to-do list agent, following, I'm using the getting things done framework typically for my to-do lists. A lot of information about the loop description, that's pretty much similar as we had before. But then the most tricky part is a description of all the tools and actions it can do. Just to specify that from what it needs to know there, description, all additional information it might need. Because these LLMs doesn't know anything about what's there yet. So I carefully need to inform it, else it will make guesses. And once you start making guesses, you get into tricky water and maybe enter the domain of hallucinations. That's the part we really want to avoid that, because then it will quickly crash and burn. But even that very lengthy prompt you just saw, the could still find ways to make tricky mistakes. So for example, with the previous prompt, it sometimes made mistakes like this, that it, for the move action task, decided to make a slightly different format or do other things that make it really hard to parse this. Because now the project ID is one time called project ID, the other times project, and it's, these subtle differences make it very hard to parse. So the solution I found that works rather well is to actually define a Pydantic model. Pydantic is a nice library that allows you to define data models and all kinds of additional information about what is this specific attribute, nice descriptions, or other validation things like regular expressions. And the really thing I really liked about this is that it also has a method called schema, and then you can automatically export it to a JSON schema, as you can see here on the right side. And the nice thing about this is that this basically is a summarization of how I want the response of the action. And everything is already there. These LLMs are trained on a large code corpus of code, so they're really efficient at reading code. So this is way more expressive than me trying to explain all this in natural language. So then as a developer, I can just define an action schema, and the LLM can read it based on the JSON schema. Nice thing about that is that your available actions becomes quite a bit shorter, at least the part I need to write. The general text the LLM sees is still on par in length, but the part I need to write is way shorter. I can just inject the schema over there, remove a lot of white spaces, and it's nice and condensed over there. So for me, being lazy is already quite a bit easier again. But still, it found other ways to cheat. So the thing that happened here is that it had to move a lot of tasks, and it's kind of decided, okay, it's too much to do everything, so I just say, my plan is to move every task over there and say that as an action. But that action didn't exist in my schemas. So then it crashed again. I had another bug. So then I decided, okay, these schemas work well. Maybe take it even one level further. Let's let the LLM only respond in JSON, follow this entire response. So the previous React framework we were talking about, let's just encode that in one giant pydantic model, in this React response model. Now we also have encoded the tot here, so it needs to it now always need to respond with a JSON object that has a tot attribute, and then it can only respond with an action that is defined over here. So then you get the response like you see here on the right side. Tot I need to, and an action with a specific type and all the attributes that needs to be there. Works rather well. So other nice part, my work becomes even more shorter. I don't need to explain the React framework anymore because it's already being generated there automatically with a schema. Now, the only thing I need to tell it is about the general context, about the to-do list, and what its kind of general instructions are, and that it only is allowed to respond in JSON using this specific schema. My prompt becomes way shorter, at least the part I need to write. Other thing that's also really nice is that it works really well with the new matching keyword from Python 3.10. So I can just parse the response schema and check if it's one of these specific models. So it becomes way easier to actually parse this stuff. And then I can act and call REST APIs based on these specific actions. The responses are now working quite well, but still it could make some kind of mistakes. For example, hallucinate some kind of task or project ID that doesn't exist. And the thing I found that works rather well is the thing you actually do for other developers when they make mistakes, is actually write good error messages, good exceptions. And if you actually, the previous match statement, if you wrap that entire thing in a try-catch block and replace the observation with your error message from your exception and give that back to the LLM, it actually could quite often fix its own mistake, as long as you tell what the mistake was, maybe give a suggestion from, okay, there is no project ID with that, so you should use this action that maybe has the proper information, and that way it quite often could fix its own mistake, which is quite interesting to see. One thing that was especially when the one time there was an update from OpenAI, and they released a new retrained model. And this one was a bit more apologetic than the previous one. We probably all seen it. It says from, oh, my apologies, I can't answer that. Here it even did it if it made a mistake in the JSON schema, then it still responded with the proper JSON schema, but it made some apologies beforehand because it didn't do it. So what do you do with this kind of things? You throw more AI at the problem. What I did is that I have the original base schema I need to adhere to, and I asked another LLM to say from, okay, I have got this response, it needs to adhere to this schema, and I have this exception. In Pydantic, it's really nice, it has quite clear exceptions already, so I didn't even need to write those exceptions yet. I give that an error message, and I let it iterate at most 3 times, and it would always fix it. The first time, maybe it got it wrong, but the second time would always fix it. And the nice thing is, if you replace then the previous response with that, with the new correct response, and you build that up in your history, is that you are basically generating few short examples. And then for your first action, it sometimes makes this mistake, but because you generate few short examples, it becomes way harder for the model to actually deviate from that. So what are the lessons learned for me during this project? The first one is that code is way more expressive and stricter than natural languages. LLMs are really good at understanding this. So if you find yourself writing really hard prompts, these JSON schemas work really, really well. They're way more expressive. You can even define these like regex patterns in there. They're really good at understanding those things, and you can be way more explicit than the hundreds of lines of text you need to explain it. Another thing is that you must be extremely clear in your description. That was one of the tricky parts, is that if you are ambiguous in your question, of the task you wanted to do, is that it starts guessing what you actually meant. So originally I tried to work with clear my inbox. That was a bit too abstract for it. I needed to be a bit more clear on what actually do I mean, what do I want it to do. So eventually you write these kind of instructions. It still figures out its own plan on how to actually do this with the API calls, but you still need to be very clear with your requirements. Other thing that was really surprising for me was that LLMs are surprisingly well at fixing their own issues. Here's an example of the thing I was previously talking about. Here you see that it's trying to create a project that doesn't exist, already exists. And then, oh, I need to accomplish this task, but I don't need to know the ID yet. And it calls the get project actions and get the final result, the real ID in that sense. And the final lesson learned is that there's still a lot of open questions in that sense from what is proper sandboxing, because it works all quite well, but due to those ambiguities of what you actually mean, I'm not sure if I'm quite ready to give it a delete action yet. So moving tasks is fine, but I still want to recover if it goes wrong. So it's a fun thing that works, but bringing it in production, I'm not so quite sure yet. If you're interested in the code, it's all open source and this repo. And yeah, if there are any questions, I'm happy to answer them.